Welcome back to my channel. Today I want to talk about a type of creature that is known in many cultures, but it's not quite the same in Irish mythology. Let's talk about the werewolf. You might know the werewolf as an instinct-driven beast, once transformed under the full moon, following its bloodthirst and losing complete control over itself, and which can only be stopped by silver. But that's not the kind of werewolf we're talking about today. The Irish werewolf is much different from these depictions. The Irish werewolf is known as Conroicht or Faoladh, and there is no record of them having any weakness to silver. And in contrast to their European counterparts, they do not need the full moon to transform, but can mostly transform at will and keep full control over their actions. The Irish Faelad has certain similarities to the Scottish Wolver, and is in general seen as a good creature and the guardian, not as a savage monster. Some even say they are the protectors of wounded men, of children and of lost souls. One Irish legend tells of a farmer who discovers a family of Faelad living in a nearby forest. The Faelads are not harmful towards him at all, but they are very thankful. For the farmer once had saved a wolf cub, not knowing it was their son, and to thank him, they protected him and his farm. However, there are many different stories about werewolf-like creatures in the Irish folklore, and like I said, most of them are kind and in complete control over the transformation, but there are some tales that paint a different picture. The probably best known is the one of the werewolves of Ossory, a medieval kingdom between today's County Kilkenny and County Laois. The legend says that the Ossorian people lived under an ancient curse. Every 7 years, a female and a male human had to turn into a wolf and live as a wolf for those 7 years. In that time, they had to survive unscathed, for any wound they would get as a wolf would turn up on their human body. If they survived the 7 years, they would turn back into humans and live their life as those, while the next pair had to turn into wolves for 7 years. During those 7 years, though, they would behave like normal wolves, attacking sheep and cattle, and if they died as a wolf, there was no coming back as a human. There is even a tale of a traveling priest who encountered two of those Ossorians while in the wolf form, during the 12th century. The priest was traveling with a novice from today's Ulster to today's County Meath. During their journey, they crossed lands which still stuck with the old beliefs. One night, they camped in the forest of Ossory and heard a mysterious voice. And when the novice already fled in fear, never to be seen again, the wolf, to whom the voice belonged, showed himself to the priest. He told him of the curse of Ossory, which was laid upon them by Abbot Natalis, who was long gone, and that he is one of the cursed, but a Christian. He pleaded the priest to come and look after his companion, the female cursed wolf, who was near to death. The priest fought with his fear, but followed the wolf into the woods, and gave the other wolf the last rites before she finally passed away. The other wolf then thanked the priest and disappeared into the woods to live out the rest of the 7 years and turn human again. Another legend says that there were indeed Ossorians who could transform into wolves whenever they pleased, leaving their human bodies behind in a death-like state until they would return. But if their bodies were moved, they would be stuck in the form of a wolf until the end of their lives. It was said that they had this ability because they were the descendants of Laignech Fáelad. Laignech Fáelad, according to the Queer Man, was the ancestor of a tribe of werewolves, who were related to the kings of Ossory. He was able to change into a wolf shape, as was his offspring, and together they would go hunting and occasionally kill cattle, just as normal wolves would. He and his warriors have more of the traditionally known werewolves, for when recruited by kings in times of war, they had many characteristics of monsters. They were said to follow Conroicht, the Crooked One, a bloodthirsty god to whom King Tiganmar sacrificed people by beheading them. However, they were said to come from Tipperary and would fight as mercenaries for any king willing to pay their price. But their price was not made of jewels or gold. As payment, they demanded the flesh of newborn babies, on which they would feast. Still, many kings were willing to pay that price, for they were fearsome warriors, brutal and ruthless in battle, and just as fierce as the wolves they took the shape of. But it can be assumed that their Ossorian descendants inherited their abilities to shapeshift, but not their bloodthirst. Another ancient legend tells the story of three sisters, the daughters of Ertach, who were said to be werewolves and to annually emerge from a cave to slaughter sheep during a harvest feast, and who were finally lured in with music and killed. So I admit, in some of those legends, the Irish werewolves just look as bad and monstrous as the commonly known ones. But in general, Irish werewolves are guardians, living in harmony with humanity, and even helping those who are kind to them. And all of those legends originate from a time when, well, the wolf was a common sight in Ireland, when Ireland was even known as the Wolfland. And maybe an interesting fact, wolf in Irish is called Mactir, which literally translates to son of the land. So it's not really a wonder that a wolf has a prominent role in Irish folklore. Sadly, since then, the wolf went extinct in Ireland. The last one died in 1786, to our knowledge. But today, efforts were made to bring the wolf back to Ireland. So maybe one day, the wolf will be a common sight in Ireland again. The wolf, the son of the land. Thank you for listening. If you like this video, please leave a thumbs up. And if you want to know more about Irish and Celtic folklore, take a look at my other videos. See you next time. Bye!